I can't stay.
Faithful. Good morning. Glad to see you all, church. Good morning to all of you on Facebook that are with us this morning. It is so good to be in the house of the Lord. And for all of those of you who thought that I was not coming today, I was a little late getting here. I had some printer drama at home, and that's always bad, right? So we are glad to be here with you today. So glad to be with our band. And let me introduce people that are serving today. It takes a lot of people to serve God the way that we know God wants to be served. Kara Coffey, Scott Hall, Mallory and Louise Melchor, our fabulous Pat is here with us. And by her side is Marcelo. Randine is here. Debbie and Mamie are here. And so welcome to worship this morning. This morning, this is actually Shepherd's Day, the day that we talk about the Good Shepherd who loves us, who cares for us, his flock. Such a wonderful thing to be a part of the flock of Jesus. And so what we learn, of course, is that God's divine love is just embodied in him. And it's a powerful thing to be loved by God. And so this is the call. Church, today we lean into this day with the strength that we have. Okay. Church, we lean into this day with the strength that we have.
We lift up our heads to meet the day.
God sends out a call that will not let us go.
We fortify our hearts in compassion and action.
If darkness still lingers, faith and determination call us to set out, for we are called to rediscover our joy. Amen.
Stand and join us as we sing our opening song. Come, now is the time to worship.
Time.
God's people, it's a wonderful thing to be together, to pray for those we love, to pray for those with needs, to pray for our world together, and to know that God hears us and that God answers. Amen?
Amen.
God is our good shepherd and the one who tends us, his flock, and tends the world around us. God is with us today, and God hears. So let's all take now and let's gather everyone into our hearts, everyone who needs God's tender touch, everyone that we know that's in need of healing or wholeness in some way, and let's carry them with our God to our God in prayer today. Precious God, teach me to love with your heart. Teach me to live in the power of your Spirit. Teach me to live in the light of your presence. Teach me to love to the beat of your heart. We pray today, O God, for the beauty of the world and all of its diversity, and we give you thanks, O God. Let us pray together. May our gratitude to you fill our days. We need your healing, O Holy One, for our troubled planet and for our nation, for all those who are struggling in body and mind relationships and in spirit. We remember those who are suffering, how grateful we are for your loving mercies. Good Shepherd, guide us to hope, to peace, to love, and to joy. Be with us as we participate in ministries of healing and hope through this church, in our community, in region, nation, and the world. And give us the courage and the strength to be your disciples in all the circumstances of our life. Let us pray together. Come, O God,
and restore our lives. Teach me to pray in the power of Easter, following Christ in the life of his brethren. Teach me to act with compassion and justice. Teach me to love with your heart.
Be with each of us now. And may your Spirit ever call us to engage with you, with the needs of those around us. Lead us, guide us, surround us, and fill us. Let us pray together. Come, Holy Spirit, come. Teach me to love with your heart of compassion. Teach me to trust in the word of your promise. Teach me to hope in the day of your coming. And teach me to love with your heart. We ask it in Jesus' most precious name. And now together we lift this prayer that he left us all by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Amen.
And now, the peace of the risen Christ is with you.
And also with you.
You are invited to turn around and wave at everyone and share the peace of Christ with everyone. Hey, all you guys at home, glad to see you this morning.
Please stand and join with us as we sing Hosanna.
I love this song.
Thank you.
Amen. So I am absolutely thrilled today to see all the youth that we have here, right? Great to see you all today, and thank you, Gary, and thank you, Sandy. I see Helen back here, and I see our youth. And it is a wonderful thing to have you back in church with us this morning. So today, we've been talking this last few weeks about dreamers. And it's really important, I think, during, when particularly as a youth, as a child or as a youth, to pay attention to the dreams that you have. You know, a lot of times I think our youth don't feel like they have a lot of power. You know, we're just kids, right? We're just kids. Maybe our parents teach us that, but those dreams that God plants in our hearts are those ways that God is working in our life, you know, to show us his will and to take us to where God is trying to take us. Today, first of all, I wanted to celebrate Earth Day. Earth Day was this past week. But our story today about our dreamer is about a young girl named Greta Thunberg. I hope if Pam Larson or Dave are actually going to see this, I hope they're not going to make fun of the way I just said Thunberg, because I know they probably say that better than I will. But she is a Swedish girl, and her biggest dream is that the leaders of the world will take action to stop or slow down climate change and to start taking care of our planet. For some of us, you know, we think of the dreams that we have, and her life began with having scary bad dreams. She had some bad dreams that nobody was ever going to do anything about climate change. And so she began talking about those fears and trying to make a difference in the world with her dreams about a healthy environment. And she shared her dreams with her parents. They made signs and stood outside of government buildings trying to share her dreams with people that are decision makers. And this past year, she was nominated for a Nobel Prize. So she's a person who took her dreams and has done just really amazing and powerful things with them. This past week on Earth Day, she actually, by Zoom, spoke to Congress about some of the facts that she knew about climate change, which just seems almost unbelievable for a child from Sweden, I think, right? But here are some of the things that she said. She said, "I have a dream that powerful people will take climate crisis seriously. At first, I felt like I was the only one who cared about the climate and about our crisis, but the world is waking up and change is coming." So she's called for governments all around the world to do more about emissions and has pleaded for people to start investing their money in ways that will not damage our environment. She dreams of a time when companies would use their money to restore nature, because God calls for all of us to care for our creation. So maybe we could all have some dreams like hers. Amen. Let's share our repeat after me prayer. We offer thanks,
for
dreamers true,
for all they are,
and all they do.
Let us become
dreamers too, and bring new life to be in you. Amen.
Good morning, Chapel Hill.
Good morning.
Please join me in the prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit. As the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Amen. As these scriptures are read, you're invited to stand or sit or kneel, whichever position creates an attitude of reverence and focus. Now hear these words, first from the Gospel of John, chapter 10, verse 11 through 17, and then second from 1 John, chapter 3, verses 16 through 18, and 23 through 24. Jesus said, "I'm the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand, who is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep, he sees the wolf coming, he leaves the sheep, and he runs away. And then the wolf snatches them and scatters them, and the hired hand runs away because a hired hand doesn't care for the sheep." Jesus reiterates, "I am the good shepherd. I know my own and my own know me, just as God knows me and I know God. And I lay down my life for the sheep." Now here's some good news for us. I have other sheep that do not belong to this fold. I must bring them also, and they will listen to my voice. So there will be one flock, one shepherd. For this reason, the Holy One loves me. Why? Because I lay down my life in order to take it up again. And now from 1 John 3, we know love by this, that Christ laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for one another. Now, how does God's love abide in anyone who has all the world's goods and sees another in need and yet refuses to help? Little children, and that's not meant to be demeaning. John said, "Little children, let us love, not only in word or speech, but in truth and action. And this is God's commandment, that we should believe in the name Jesus and love one another just as Christ has commanded us. And then all who obey his commandments abide in him, and he abides in them. By this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit that he has given us." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
You may be seated.
Stars in their place.
Amen, amen. We are God's beloved. Amen?
Amen.
What a wonderful, wonderful, comforting, comforting, comforting song. What a wonderful, comforting thought. Let us pray, everybody. Precious God, we are so grateful to you. We come today aware that we are your chosen, that we are your beloved, and that you are ours. And that even when we're not perfect, you still love us. You are our shepherd, and we are your flock. And so, God, as we come now around this word, as simple as it is, Lord, speak into our hearts today that we might feel your comfort and your peace and your joy, that we might be your people. Lord, we lift this time to you in Jesus' precious name. Amen. So, church, today Jesus tells us that he is the good shepherd, which, after this past year that we've just had, is that not just the most comforting words in the world? You know, we, so much uncertainty for a year, you know, so many people that have been sick for a year, people that have lost their jobs, so many things that just seem like they were just out of our control. And yet Jesus, our shepherd, was always with us. He was always with us, watching over us, caring for us. So reassuring, especially knowing that our shepherd is Almighty God himself. Amen?
Amen.
We come to this scripture today, and what we see are that Jesus uses these holy words, I am. This is one of the passages of 8 where Jesus tells his disciples in very decisive language exactly who he is and exactly what his relationship is with our Father God. That is the holiest word, so holy to his people, the Israelites. You know, Moses heard God say that at the burning bush when he asked God, who he was. God said, I am. Just tell the Egyptians, I am, right? And so through the New Testament, we hear Jesus say 8 times, I am, to tell us just who he is. He is our life sustainer. He is the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger. I am the light of the world. He is the one that dispels the darkness in our life. I am the door. He is the one by which we enter. I am the resurrection and the life. He is the one who gives us life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no one comes to the Father except by me. He is the way. And I am the true vine, the one that we all cling to for our life, right? And before Abraham was, I am. Today he says, I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd gives his life for his sheep. You know, the New Testament was written in Greek, and when he uses the word good, it is the word kalos, which literally means good, but it's in a different kind of holistic kind of way. Barclay says that this is kind of like saying the good doctor. And that's something that we don't really hear a whole lot anymore, right? Some people probably watch that on TV. It kind of has this charming little ring to it. But years ago, people knew a good doctor who came to their home. You know, when my sister was 5, she was gravely ill with rheumatic fever. And our good doctor, Dr. Carey, used to make house calls, and he'd bring a big black bag, and it would have a stethoscope and medicine and all kinds of stuff that would make her feel better. Take her temperature, he'd tell her what to do, and she would feel good all of a sudden. Good doctors are devoted to people who need their help. You know, that's what they did. They give themselves to care for their patients. When I was in Chicago, I knew a very, very good doctor that practiced medicine in a clinic For people who are unable to pay for chemotherapy and other life-giving services, and a lot of homeless people who really needed her help were afraid to go see her, so she went to the shelters to treat them. And our church knew her because she came into our church and treated people at our shelter. But her love for underserved people and underloved people came from her love for Jesus, our Good Shepherd. And this good doctor learned the craft, her craft, at the feet of the Good Shepherd. Jesus has a special place in his heart for us, but he also has a special place in his heart for people who really need him, right? People who really need. And he calls us to love them too. He is our Good Shepherd. I was thinking back now to when we lived on the border. I think probably not many of us know a shepherd per se. Probably very few of us here have ever tried to raise sheep. Has anybody ever done that? I saw one hand go up back here. What I would say, because I knew a lot of people on the border that raise sheep for a living, and I would tell you that sheep are very, very cute, and they are very, very easy to love from a distance. Okay? They're cute. They're fuzzy. They're like little toys to look at them. But sheep growers say that they are absolutely exasperating if you have to take care of them every day, because they always seem to find these holes in a fence that they crawl through, but they're not able to get back through to the other side. Okay? They can never get back in. And they tell me that the entire flock plays this game of follow the leader, right? Even if it's following the leader straight off a cliff, they're following. They don't any of them see what's ahead. And so as cute as sheep are, it isn't quite as easy to love them if you have to deal with them day by day. And herein lies the analogy of our Good Shepherd, okay? Because sometimes we're great people. We're cute, right? We're cute, we're sweet, we do great things. But sometimes we're not easy to love either. We're just not. But Jesus is our Good Shepherd, and he loves us, even when we make mistakes. In our passage, he is speaking directly to his disciples, and he assures them, "My sheep hear my voice." No ifs, no buts, no exceptions. If you belong to Jesus, then you are one of his sheep. And thank God for that, right? You know, I think sometimes this is kind of foreign to us thinking about these things, but the first people that heard this definitely knew what he was talking about. They all saw big herds of sheep. They knew there was a big sheepfold that had an awful lot of different, what do you say, groups of sheep that gathered there together, flocks of sheep, I suppose, that gathered together. And in the morning, they would all sleep together at night, but in the morning, each shepherd would return. He would call out to them, but they responded only to their shepherd's voice. There could be hundreds of different shepherds, lots and lots of sheep together at the pond, but they knew exactly who their shepherd was. And when they heard this singular, undeniable voice of their true shepherd, it didn't matter if they were light or if they were dark or they were a different breed, if they were young or if they were old, if they were slender or if they were a little heavier, if they were high-end sheep or if they were budget rack sheep. All that ever really mattered was that they were his sheep. That's it. All that mattered is who they belong to. Jesus said, I am the good shepherd. And the good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. He's talking to us about sheep and shepherds, talking about himself, talking about God, and talking about God's relationship with us. And he is telling us all that he cares for us just like a shepherd cares for a flock, that he cares for us with this kind of deep knowing us through and through and through, with this intimacy that only a really loving and good shepherd has for his flock. You know, every good shepherd knows all of the sheep. They know all their little quirks. They know all their little separate little sheep-like personalities, I think. And this good shepherd, knowing and loving his flock so dearly, is willing to do whatever it takes to keep them safe from the harm that would otherwise befall them. When the wolf comes, the good shepherd will stand between the wolf and the sheep, caring more for the sheep than for his safety, which is exactly what our good shepherd did, right? So I want us to think now, because we have just come through the Lenten season, and we are looking at our good shepherd. And what we see is this, is that our good shepherd stood between us and terrible, terrible death and destruction. You see, as sin and death threatened to destroy us forever, really to deprive us of love and this life that God wants us to have, God put himself in harm's way. And this is what Jesus is saying by saying, I am. God himself put himself in harm's way. God took our flesh. He didn't just take it. He took it all the way. He took it all the way. When the power of sin and death tried to break him, tried to seize him, tried to claim him for their own, Jesus stood firm. He did not run away. He freely offered his life. It was not taken from him. And Jesus did this because this is what our God is like. God gives all that God is and all that God has to us because he loves us, and he gives it to us for free. Christ is the good shepherd, and part of that means that he's good to us, but he is also good to others, right? Christ not only gave his life for us, but he gave it for all. He has not only come into our lives, but is always coming into the life of others. And he says, they will hear my voice. And so, you know, Chapel Hill, as we are all gathered here today, we need to beware of those people that are around us at all times, because Jesus' voice extends far beyond us, does it not? It extends far into our community. From all the words I'm saying to you, Jesus is always reaching for other people. You know, we come here and we worship together because we love each other, and we come to hear Jesus' voice. We come to hear him reveal his truth to us. But might he also be with others at the same time? Yes, of course he is. He says, I am the good shepherd. And what he speaks to us, he speaks to all. Bishop Wildman, who is my favorite bishop really of all time, tells about having Reverend Dr. Billy Graham come and help them celebrate the 75th year of Duke Chapel. And Dr. Graham preached, I'm imagining, just a fire-breathing sermon, you know. He's so awesome. But what Dr. Willeman said was this. He said, I don't remember much about the sermon, but he said, I do remember him saying after all of it was over, he said, you will have a wonderful ministry here. He said, because many of these students and many of this faculty are unaware that Jesus is eager to have them. Imagine that. A seminary full of professors teaching theology, students that are there to learn to become pastors with all the money in the world to make sure that we have a Christian nation, right? And Dr. Graham says, many of these students in this faculty are unaware that Jesus Christ is eager to have them. Are we aware that Jesus is eager to have us? Don't be quiet. Are we aware that Jesus is eager to have us?
Yes.
Yes. Jesus is eager to have us all, and he will not rest until everyone hears his voice and is safe in his fold. We follow our good shepherd out of love. He asks us to follow him. He came to conquer death. His death would have been totally meaningless without his resurrection. He came to die that we might live. He came that he might break the bonds of death and the power of sin over us. God could have chosen another way, could he not? But he did not. He did not. Jesus loves us. Jesus loves us. Are we aware? Amen?
Amen.
Let us pray. Precious and holy God, you are the way, the truth, and the life, and you are our good shepherd. Lord, you are the one that we look to. You are the one who leads us. You are the one we follow. Now as we worship together here, Lord, and as we lift our hearts to you, as we lift our resources to you, help us to know, Lord. Help us to bless others' lives. Help us to bless the lives of our ministries. Help us to bless people in our neighborhood. Lord, we ask it all in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Amen. Please stand and join us as we sing Wonderful Words of Life.
Wonderful words of life.
has a line in it that I just love, and it always reminds me of the Emmaus community when I hear it. That the line that says, "He is wooing us to heaven." How many people do we have in here that have been to Emmaus? Yeah, that's what I thought. You know, those are words that we hear at Emmaus all the time, is how God woos us. God loves us into his kingdom. So today, we just have a few announcements to make. And, yes. Okay. All right. So the question for us today is, how do we know that our lives are faithful? It's because we love each other, by which we know that we are followers of Jesus, the ever-attentive shepherd. In the face of our world that strives to foster everyone for themselves, our hope is that others will know that we are Christians by our love. Let us love others, our neighbors, and our planet in order to build up the whole through our offerings on this day. I want to just say that our offerings go for a lot of missions here at this church. Every week it is my pleasure to watch as our food pantry folks give every Tuesday. There are so many other things that we do. Yesterday I watched as we had some of our youth that sat in the middle of our hallway here and took and made little crafts, some things that will be given away for Mother's Day. But every cent that we use here, that we give here, I believe goes for our missions, for our ministries, in ways that is that we're very, very good stewards with it all. So let's pray. Precious God, we ask you now that you bless this offering, that you bless this church, Lord, that you continue to work in our lives, that you continue, Lord, to be with us. And we thank you that you are our good shepherd. Amen. Amen.
To your name, oh Lord, for your name.
I just have a few announcements here. Please submit newsletter articles by tomorrow, if possible. Our worship team meeting is tomorrow at 3:30. The Tuesday lunch bunch, and I'm not sure who that is. It's Ruth Ann. All right, I see the hand back there. Great. The Tuesday lunch bunch will meet at Acadiana at 11 a.m. on April 27th. It's a fun group of folks who meet for great fellowship food. Yay! All right. Next rummage sale is Saturday, May 1st from 8 a.m. to 1 p.m. And spaces for rent are $15. Children's Sunday School has resumed on Zoom on Wednesdays at 6:30. So parents, if you need a link to be able to get your children on for Sunday school, be sure and just email the church office and Pat will send that to you. The Agape Sunday School class is meeting again in person at 9:45. I think Brother Paul back here is leading that group, right? We just want everybody back. And also this next week will be communion. And so we have self-contained communion elements for our people who are still shut in at home. We're glad to deliver those. We have a congregational care team, or I will bring them if you would like. So just call the office and let us know, and we'll make sure that you get one. Is there anything that I'm missing here?
No.
No? Well, okay. Marcelo said it has to be right, right? So, church, I just want to ask you today, what would our life look like if every day we seek to follow Jesus? If every day we seek to see the Good Shepherd in our life, I think it would just be amazing, right? Because the Good Shepherd loves us. He is our Good Shepherd, and he asks us to follow him. So may we abide in our Good Shepherd, the most beautiful, excellent, commendable, and admirable one who knows us one by one and lays down his life for us, so that we might be an extension of the Good Shepherd for others. Amen?
Amen.
May the loving God, the risen Christ, and the Holy Spirit fill you all for the days ahead. And all God's people said, Amen.
Amen.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please stand as we sing our closing song, Victory in Jesus.